All right, welcome back to Computer Science E75. This is Lecture 5, JavaScript. So I guess two announcements. One, not to draw undue attention, but I see Scott brought coffee tonight, but only for himself. So some of you might recall last week's suggestion, but he seems to have taken care of that partly. Just tea. But last week seemed to work pretty well when we asked for questions beforehand. So I'll turn this into an open floor for a moment if there are questions about project, what are we up to? Project two or one. Recent material? Anything tangential? Websites you visited this week but thought the UIs were horrible? I don't have any this week, most, yeah? Anything at all? So it seems to be, if we ask the questions before the camera goes on, then they flow. But all right, not tonight. All right, so one comment about project one. In answer to a question actually that came up last week about how the projects will be evaluated now that they're becoming less about just HTML, which the first one was, and now more about programmatic stuff. So this is a key that you'll see on the PDFs that you get back from the teaching fellows. But as the project spec themselves said, there are essentially three primary axes along which we will evaluate the projects. Correctness, just how well do they implement the specs as written and meet the requirements. Design, just how well implemented was your code? Are you doing things efficiently, completely inefficiently? Does the design make sense with respect to some of the principles we've introduced in lecture and section? And then style, which is purely aesthetic, or variables named foobar and baz, or something more descriptive. Are things indented reasonably well? And is your code commented? So something purely aesthetic. And then finally, for projects that also have some aspect of configuration, like htaccess files, a couple of points will be assigned to that. And then also for prose answers, like your README, there will be just a couple of points assigned to that. But the essence of the grade will be applied exactly where you presumably are spending the most time, with these different weights applied. So correctness worth the most for this particular project, design a factor of 2, and style a factor of 1. So you'll see that again on the PDF. Yeah, and that should guide perhaps your approach to future projects as well. Any questions? No? Yeah?
Not related to this, but.
Sure.
Project 2. So I'm having a little tough time setting up MySQL sort of admin portion on my local machine.
Okay.
I'm getting memory calls for a particular DLL. I saw some posts about.
So off the top of my head, I have no idea how to feel that one. So I would suggest just post specifically yourself, or drop staff an email letting us know exactly what the symptoms are, since I'm not sure I have a general answer to that.
But the best way would be to do it on a machine and then do a database dump and import it on CS75.
So in terms of maintaining your own database, the easiest way, I think, by far, is to just download the XAMPP installation if you have not gone that route, because it installs pretty much everything for you. If you've not gone that route and are installing MySQL, you're fine. You would just ultimately want to run MySQL dump or use PHP MyAdmin on your own site to just dump the tables and or data that's in them. And then on PHP MyAdmin on cs75.net, you might have noticed an import tab. If you click import, you can upload any number of file formats, one of which is just a raw SQL dump, a .sql file, and that will just copy the data over to our server. And that's a simple approach. Or, as was discussed on the bulletin board, in theory, you can also connect to cs75.net's database from your own machine if you follow some of the directions that were posted there. Yeah?
Just so my colleague doesn't feel bad, I'm also, when I try running the XAMPP MySQL, when I turned on MySQL, I'm getting lots of memory crashes,
okay.
Null pointers in MySQL admin. I just gave up and I'm using. I don't want to spend time debugging it. I'm just using cs75.net.
Okay. So
turn off the service.
Sure. So turn to your classmates and the staff, certainly. But and Google, frankly, is probably your friend with arcane error messages. So other questions? Yeah?
When submitting the project, will we want to dump the database out first and have that as part of the file that all get collected up? Or you'll just...
Nope, no need. Because we're having you create a new database for each of the projects, we'll expect that you don't touch it, much like you shouldn't touch the code. But we'll just grab the data from the database. All right, so tonight we turn our attention to things client-side, at least for a bit. It's in tonight where we'll discuss JavaScript and some of the client-side uses for it. And then in the next two lectures, we'll continue this discussion of JavaScript, but specifically in the context of Ajax, which will have some client-server interaction. But tonight, there's a lot of juicy things that we can do with JavaScript, even in terms of validation of data client-side, doing some neat UI tricks that are far too underutilized, I think, on sites. Simple ones being, like, it'd be really nice if my cursor were blinking in the username field when I visit a page to save me one click. So even simple things like this are very easily managed with this particular tool. Here's some references that I would recommend. The top couple are perhaps canonical references for JavaScript maintained by the Mozilla group. But you might also find the reference and tutorial at W3 Schools particularly helpful as well. And we might take a look at a couple of examples on the latter tonight. But the first and most important thing to say, if you're not all that familiar with JavaScript, is that, frankly, I think it's matured a lot over the years. There was a time not all that long ago where use of JavaScript was largely limited to gratuitous use of pop-up windows and asking for confirmations and just not elegant UI things, but certainly it was easy to get the job done. But it's proved to be, especially as it's aged and the newer versions have come out, a much more sophisticated tool that underlies some of the most popular websites today. Google has done certainly some brilliant things with using JavaScript to drive Google Maps, Google Calendar. All of their tools make heavy use, for the most part, of JavaScript. Gmail, for instance, supports keyboard shortcuts and things like this. Can JavaScript now make possible? Unfortunately, the catch is that much like you've seen some disparities in implementations of CSS and XHTML, you're going to see some more when it comes to JavaScript. But fortunately, some very smart folks with a lot of free time have also put a lot of effort into developing open source toolkits and frameworks like UI, Yahoo's library, that you can pull off the shelf and hopefully turn a blind eye to some of those cross-platform issues. So we'll touch on that a bit tonight. The most important thing to say, though, to make clear on day one here, is that JavaScript is client-side. So this code is not executed on the server. Even if you're generating the code on the server, it's ultimately executed on the browser. So that has a number of implications, some for security, some for performance. Performance is perhaps the best one to pluck off first. Because it's running client-side, you can do a lot of logical manipulations of data and of the user interface on the client side, that is, in the browser, without ever talking to the server. And the more data, for instance, you can prefetch, as we'll see in the next two lectures via Ajax and such, the much more dynamic of an interface can you provide, a la, again, Google Maps or kayak.com and the like. So this is perhaps one of the ways, perhaps the simplest way, that you can embed JavaScript in a web page. So it boils down to use of the script tag, open tag, and close tag. Anything that goes between these tags, provided you've said something like type equals text slash JavaScript, which is meant to be its MIME type, will be executed or should be executed by the browser when this page is loaded into memory. So this is out of context now, but imagine an HTML tag up top, a head tag, and then down below some body tags, open and close, close HTML tag, and some other content. Now this tag here, this element, can be put in different places in a web page. Perhaps the most common is to put the script tag inside the head element. Up until now, you might have put only mentions of link elements for CSS and the title elements. Well, typically you would put JavaScript code like this in the head of an element to ensure that it is all loaded before the body of the page, which is useful so that you're not making any assumptions sometimes as to when the whole page has been loaded. But it can actually appear nested inside the page itself, per a post I made to the forums last night. But we'll see different examples. Why have I added this somewhat cryptic syntax that we've actually seen before? This line here and the one below the script tag. Yeah, it effectively comments it out, or if you care about the validity of your document with respect to, say, XHTML, well, if you so much as use a less than sign or a greater than sign or an ampersand, as in a Boolean and context in JavaScript, well, that's odds are that's going to throw off something like the W3C's validator or the browser specifically that's reading the file. So by encapsulating all JavaScript, which I've waved my hands at here for a moment with just the ellipse there, the dot, 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 you're telling the browser to effectively ignore, or for the purposes of validation, all of the stuff between the open C data section and the close tag. So years ago, you would instead just see an HTML comment, open bracket, bang, hyphen, hyphen. And that's fine, but that was not so much a solution to validity, because it doesn't tell the parser built into the browser to ignore, rather not to parse, the following data with respect to tag elements. Yeah?
Can you
if you have like a addition JavaScript file to just refer, you need the code also?
Excellent question. So the other way to embed JavaScript is by way of something like this, whereby you reference a specific file by adding a source attribute to the script tag. And no, you only need to have JavaScript in that external file. You don't need to worry about bracketing things in a CData section. A third approach to embedding JavaScript, just to set the stage, is also to specify not the type equals quote unquote text slash JavaScript, but to specify the actual version of JavaScript that you want the browser to support before it dives in to execute the following lines of code. This is typically, though, recommended against only because even though JavaScript 1.5 is one of the most recent incarnations of JavaScript, you'll still see differences across browsers in their implementation of it. Sometimes corner cases, to be sure, but there are more effective ways for checking whether or not some object, for instance, is supported in some version of JavaScript. So you'll see this and know that this exists, but I would say the former approach is more popular, just or more conventional using the MIME type. Yeah?
If the commented C data that's closed tell the browser to ignore the JavaScript in between, how is the JavaScript recognized by whoever needs to recognize?
It's a good question. It's really just telling the XML parser to ignore the following data and not to try to interpolate individual characters as being significant with respect to well-formedness, but it does not mean to ignore the following text. To ignore text, you would actually use, as you'll see in examples on the web, comments, which are equivalent to PHP, slash slash or slash star, like in the C programming language. So that's what the browser would use to ignore JavaScript code. All right, and one last setup detail here. And frankly, this is decreasingly necessary, I would say. But there also exists the NoScript tag, which is meant to flank, to come after typically, a script tag, which is a cue to the browser, if you don't support JavaScript, or more generally, the scripting language mentioned above, then go ahead and display this content and effectively ignore the content above that. And I say this is decreasingly necessary because even though maybe a few years ago it was a compelling security compromise to turn off JavaScript, it's not really a reasonable solution these days. And I don't think that it's all that common a case. I mean, the number of websites on the web that require JavaScript these days, frankly, abound. And so I actually think from a design perspective, it's, and this is my opinion, a reasonable requirement to expect that JavaScript be enabled. But if for whatever reasons you want to be able to handle both cases, you can at least provide the user with a message by way of that tag, because this will be displayed if and only if scripting languages are disabled in their browser. Yeah? So for mobile devices as well, I mean, presumably for a mobile device, if you have a constrained window space and such, you probably would want to cater the site to that particular platform, which you can do by detecting the user agent string that's sent. So presumably in that case, you would be sending different content. Even if not, I mean, frankly, there's a lot of sites that just don't work on my Perl because it just requires various CSS features or JavaScript features that aren't fully supported. So. More of a design question and a trade-off, certainly, but FYI. Yeah?
What has changed over the years that sort of makes JavaScript more acceptable, or is it just the distribution of hardware?
It's a good question, and maybe hard to answer with one answer, but I think just trends in software development. There's only so much you can do if you don't provide the ability to if you don't provide in a scripting language on the client side to interact in terms of the GUI to fetch additional data. I think early on, maybe it's fair to say that there were more security compromises. There were just bad implementations of JavaScript that erroneously gave the script access, say, to the local file system. So maybe Microsoft and Mozilla and the like have gotten better at sandboxing their environments. But even that's no guarantee. In theory, JavaScript security model is supposed to be such that if the JavaScript file, the .js file, or the inline JavaScript code came from a foreign website, it should not have certain privileges. It should not be able to open network connections to any site other than the domain or IP that it came from. It should not have the ability to touch files on your local file system unless you proactively are uploading them. But humans make mistakes. And so I think there's probably a history out there of security bugs that were more the fault of humans than I think of the principle of client-side scripting.
Mm-hmm. The script tags, how would you do that in the NoScript?
So if you, it actually encapsulated the code in a function. So think of it, oh, well, so if you had a function here. Well, here you wouldn't, because what this is saying is if there's no scripting support, if JavaScript has been disabled, all the browser can do is display this content. So if you actually wrote JavaScript code, it would just display verbatim with the curly braces, f function, open parentheses. You would just see what's between those tags. So whereas what's between these script tags is executed, what's between these tags is displayed. That's all. But frankly, that's not even that common these days for sites to even bother, I would say. OK, so a bit about the language, and then we'll dive right into some examples, because probably most of you have used JavaScript in some form. But we'll try to raise the bar a bit and introduce some of the interesting features about the language and also lay a foundation for next week. So even though this is another language that we're introducing just a couple weeks after PHP, frankly, the syntax is pretty similar. Right? Syntactically, it's very similar to C, C++. Even Perl without the scariness, and PHP as well. So there's this notion of break. There's the notion of switches and ifs and else, whiles, for loops. There's some neat looping constructs that you see in the newer versions of Java, like a for in construct that allows you to just iterate over data more easily. And I won't bore us with the details of examples of how to implement a for loop. We'll just see them by way of some demonstrations. But for the most part, maybe I'll make mention of var, declares a variable. JavaScript is a weakly typed language, much like PHP, where you say something's a variable. And frankly, most browsers let you not even bother saying that something's a variable. You can just start using it. So in that sense, it's very, it plays nicely, it relates well to folks who have just learned PHP can relate well to JavaScript, I think. And just to pluck off perhaps one trivia thing, what's the relationship between Java and JavaScript? Okay, nothing. Right? It's kind of a sham. And if you read the Wikipedia article, I think there's a conspiracy theory, at least, that it was a conscious decision to call it JavaScript because right around the time of its release, Java was becoming a little popular, and they kind of wanted to ride that wave. And I don't know or really care if that was the case. But it's certainly a confusing detail. And I can't imagine it was just a coincidence. So there was clearly some thought in it. So let's actually use JavaScript for the first time here. So on the course website's login page, there is the not the underwhelming, but I think still useful feature of pulling up the login page actually puts your cursor blinking in the username field, thereby saving students and, you know, the 50 students in this room 50 clicks a day if they're logging into the website. That's not a bad thing, since it only took us maybe 6 lines of code to save you all 1 click per day. So where is this code? Well, if we pull up the course's website, recall that this code was in login.php. And recall that we saw a bunch of different versions of login last week. But this is the true version that we saw, I think, a couple of weeks ago. And I'm going to scroll down past the IMAP stuff, scroll down past the cookie stuff, and just go down to the XHTML that displays the form. So here's that form again. It's going to submit a field called username, a field called password, and then there was this other field called stamp, which was the checkbox that we implemented for the website a few weeks ago. But then down below, you'll see that I actually didn't even bother putting this in the head of the page, but rather I put it after the tags that I wanted to interact with. And I specifically did this. So again, we see the C data section, the script tag up there, and then just an if else. So there's no function here. There's no function calls, because in fact, this is just an inline JavaScript. It's just going to be executed, interpreted line for line, and executed by the browser the moment this tag is encountered. So what's this thing doing? Well, it's saying if document.forms.login.username.value. This is not what you should expect with JavaScript. It's just the nature of this particular implementation. We'll see better ways to do it. Equals equals the empty string. Well, what would you infer the next two lines are doing? So if the username value is nothing, what should this script do? So it should set the focus. So you'll see, and we'll talk more about DOM, or document object model, which I think we've alluded to in previous lectures when talking about XML. But as quick background, everything in a web page can be modeled, especially if it's well-formed, valid XHTML, as a tree structure, the root of which is the HTML element. Then you have a head child, a body child, and then a bunch of other stuff hanging off of that in sort of sibling, parent, and so forth relationship. So defined for almost all of those nodes in that tree, so to speak, are some basic functions and sometimes some basic properties, one of which is a focus function. So the focus function is a method that's associated with form fields, for instance. And if you invoke that method on a particular field, what that means is the browser should give it focus, as though you, the user, clicked on that field, or as though you, the user, hit tab enough times to sort of highlight using that dashed notation that Firefox and the like use to focus on a field. The meaning being, if you just start typing or hit maybe the space bar, which of the fields are you going to interact with? Well, you're going to interact with the one field that, quote unquote, has focus. So in the context of a text field, like the username field, it's that line of code that quite simply results in the login page yielding this content with the cursor already sitting there flashing. If it weren't, I would have to hit tab a couple times or just move my mouse and click there. So again, underwhelming, but certainly useful. Questions?
The next line, you've seen that you set the value of that field to its value.
Indeed. And this is one of these annoying sort of trivia things that you learn after a while or learn after Googling, frankly. Recall that the login field, if I log in incorrectly and type in something like Malin, and actually, is it necessary in this case? Actually, in the website, now that I think of it, it actually doesn't have an effect on our login form, but it's actually a good thing that we included anyway so that it comes up. With some browsers, if we pre-populate the field, as we've done, and you give that field focus, it unfortunately puts the cursor at the beginning of the field, which is just a little counterintuitive and sort of suggests that if the user needs to fix their username, now they had to do the added step of, you know, hitting right. So this little hack, which it really is, of setting the value of that field equal to the value of itself, has in one or more browsers the effect of ensuring that the cursor is at the end of the line. And it's a stupid hack, but one of these things that you pick up by Googling. And I say it's unnecessary here because I actually forgot, and I was just following my own sort of design pattern here. When you have a form whose multiple fields get pre-populated, that makes sense. Because if you want the cursor to be blinking in a field that already has data, but because we only have a username field and a password field, the latter of which I don't pre-populate, that line of code actually has no effect in this example. But I'll leave it in there just because it's illustrative of that. Yeah?
Where does login come from? Is it that given that form that
logs? Excellent question. So let's work our way down. So in the context, and we'll talk more about this again in our Ajax lectures, this DOM, so to speak, you can sort of think of it as being referenced by this document variable, a super global, to borrow PHP speak, that's accessible to your JavaScript code anywhere. And the document refers to the web page document itself. And a document has a whole bunch of different properties and functions associated with it, which you can certainly find in an online manual. And we'll also see, by way of examples tonight, some of those properties and methods. So if I call document.forms, what that's actually returning to me effectively is an object representing, in the browser's memory, all of the forms, zero or more of them, in this current web page. If I dive in deeper and I say document.forms.login, I'm specifically retrieving, effectively, a reference to the specific form in the document called login. Well, how do I know what it's called or why it's named that? Well, one of the lines I added before I added this JavaScript code was to the form element, I actually gave it a name. So specifically now, I can reference that form by way of its name. And there is an alternative here, because you can actually get at these things by way of an array. So you can actually do something like this. If I didn't bother naming the form, quote unquote, login, or maybe I just didn't even know you could, it turns out that you could actually access this thing as an array, which is actually really, it's pretty much equivalent to an object, as we'll see later tonight. But I now have to know that the first or the zeroth form in my document is that specific form, which probably isn't a safe assumption if you're doing a lot of including of data from different files and such. So the naming approach is probably a better one. There are yet other ways of doing this, and I'll show you just one so you've seen it. You can also apply to elements in a document, sort of consistent with the idea of XML. Unique ID attributes. Like I could have called this the login form, just to give it a different name. And whereas a name can appear in multiple places in a document, an ID by nature has to be unique. But the upside of this is that if you give any element in an XHTML document an ID, you can actually call this function, document dot get element by ID, and then pass in login form. And what this will return is equivalent to what that line of code is doing. So many different ways to skin the cat, so to speak. And I'll try to introduce different ones along the way. But more useful for tonight, perhaps, is to see some of these different things, especially as you turn to online libraries, which might take different approaches. I took the simplest approach possible. Give the thing a name. It's a long line, but it's specific. It got the job done. And I didn't really have to think about how to implement this, which I shouldn't, given that I only needed some 6 lines of code in the first place. So we'll see this get element by ID function a lot more in the context of Ajax. So we'll come back to that. Yeah? Yes.
So we can have a button name login in the same form. We can have a button.
Yes. You can have an input field named that as well. So it's slightly different from the HTTP parameter. We'll see more of that. Let me defer for now on teasing the two apart. But other questions about this? Yeah. So it's a good question. It is pretty, because JavaScript's an interpreted language, much like XHTML is an interpreted markup language, the file is pretty much read from top to bottom. And so because the form that I am attempting to control with this JavaScript appeared earlier in the document, and specifically was both opened and closed earlier in the document, if the browser is behaving correctly, it should load this entire form into memory first. Thereby meaning that in that DOM, in that tree structure I've described, there's actually a node in that tree in RAM already representing that form, which means it's a safe leap of faith at this point in the document to just immediately dive in and access that form's elements. But we'll see many cases, just to foreshadow, of scripts that you don't want executing right away, because for various performance reasons, it's possible that the whole page might not be loaded into memory all at once. And you don't want scripts trying to access pieces of data that literally haven't been loaded into their appropriate place just yet. But for this example, the file is parsed and interpreted top to bottom, left to right. And so this is executed the moment the browser gets to, unless it's doing some neat optimizations, that line in the file. OK, other questions? Yeah?
Does that mean if you put the script, if you call the script in the body on load, is that the wrong time to do it?
No, so that would be OK too. And we're going to actually migrate toward this approach. In fact, let me do one thing just to relate it to another approach you might have seen. If I actually, just for various stylistic reasons or functional reasons, the functional reasons we'll see next week and the week after, if I actually define this as my init function, all right, and I'm just going to neaten things up here to make clear what exactly is the function. So I'm just wrapping this same content. I'm not changing any of the code. I rolled back those little changes I made a second ago. Sorry. There we go. All right. So now I have a function. So now actually, and remind me not to close this file because this is the real one. So now I have a function defined called init that contains the same code. Now if I reload the web page, is this code going to get executed? So no, it's not going to get executed. The function will be defined in memory. So somewhere in the browser's memory, there will be some representation of this function's existence so that it could be called elsewhere. But if I actually now want to call this, I can do a number of things. I could, rather oddly, just say init down here, because the function's been defined. I can certainly call it next. But that sort of obviates the whole need for the function in the first place if it's only meant to be called once. But very common is to use event handlers, which we'll touch on tonight, specifically. Perhaps the first one that's relevant is actually not accessible in this file. And FYI, we used to have a function called course begin and course end over the week. As some of you noticed, very late at night, I pretty much rewrote the whole website. And we now have a function called course parentheses arrow header. And same thing for footer. We'll tease apart the object notation perhaps in the future, but it's the same idea. The point being, though, because of the way I structured the site, I don't really have access to the body element that's being outputted by the page because we're using this templating system. But if I did, if I actually got rid of this template code and actually did this myself and this myself, you can actually define the onload handler to call a specific function like that. thereby making quite sure that the function is only executed on the page having been completely loaded. For most scripts, this is really immaterial. But for more sophisticated programs, certainly when we start doing more Ajax-like stuff, you will see that it's important to understand the flow of code that is being executed by the browser. Sorry, not taking a call. I'm turning my phone off for microphone interference purposes. All right. OK, any other questions on this code as I roll back all of our changes? OK, so now let's actually take things up a notch and see some different ways of doing this and actually interacting with the form and doing what's generally known as client-side validation. So realize, as a few folks have already asked, even in project one, that client-side validation, that is checking that the user has maybe filled out the whole form, checking that they actually provided a sufficiently long password, can be done entirely in JavaScript. But, dot, 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 complete that pedagogical sentiment, if you would.
You still have to do it on the server
side. You still have to, or had better do it on the server side, at least when it comes to anything related to data integrity or security, because JavaScript can be disabled, and a malicious person can still submit via raw HTTP requests any data they want to their server. So most anything you do with JavaScript, at least in terms of validation of data, should typically be driven by a goal of improving the user experience, speeding up the user interface, saving load on your server by just heading off some obvious issues of validity, not as an alternative to server-side validation. So the implication, of course, is that you already know from last week how to do server-side stuff. Now we're suggesting you do server-side stuff and client-side stuff. And absolutely, yes, it means twice as much work, but different type of work. And frankly, given some of the tools that are out there, it's increasingly compelling to do some of this stuff client-side, I think. Yeah?
If you need to validate on your server-side anyway, how does client-side validation save any processing?
In the case of error. So if a user is being really ridiculous and giving me a 6-character password instead of an 8-character password, and they attempt to do this 10 different times, if I'm not doing any client-side checking, that's 10 queries to my server just to tell the user, you know, that's a mistake, that's a mistake, that's a mistake. So that kind of processing.
Also, I mean, it's annoying to the user to have to fill out that form again and again. I mean, you can trap those values on the server side. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
So they can just go back to the password field and type in. If they forgot the numbers, they can a number. They can append a number.
No, absolutely. And just to summarize for the camera, I mean, it's really about a lot of the JavaScript stuff we'll be looking at really tonight in the next two lectures for Ajax. I mean, is about user interface and improving the user's experience and giving them more immediate feedback. And it's for this reason that folks like sites like Kayak for finding flights, because you never have to leave the page. You don't have to see the whole page reload while you sort of wait as the little icon spins for the whole page to come back. Rather, the data is integrated live, like MapQuest versus Google Maps. I mean, probably most people in this room prefer Google Maps, because you can click and scroll the content rather than clicking a left arrow, having the whole page reload and showing you the next frame of the map. So it doesn't add to the fundamental functionality of the site, but certainly enhances the experience. So let's take a look at form1.html. Let me pull this up. And you do have a printout of this tonight. And it's also available online in the source directory. So here's a form that I whipped up. No regard for aesthetics. I wanted to use as little XHTML markup as possible and just focus on the JavaScript code tonight. But this is meant to be representative of some kind of site that asks for your email address, your password, twice to make sure you're not mistyping it one or both times from what you think it is. And then that checkbox, because I wanted to add a little nuance to it so that the user, before they're allowed to successfully register, they have to agree to those terms by clicking that box, something that lawyers might like. So this file, right now, form1.html, as you can see in your printout, is just XHTML. So there's no client-side validation. There's no JavaScript whatsoever. If I go ahead and completely ignore these fields and click submit, it does, in fact, submit. And I have it submitting, if you glance quickly, to a file called process.php. That's the action attribute. And all that thing is doing is doing a print r of the request object or the get or post object, just so I can see exactly what's inside of there. So we can do a little discussion of server side stuff. But that's it. And that's not even valid XHTML. It's just a quick and dirty dump as this file here suggests. That was the extent of my server side programming for this demo. All right, but now let's add a bit of validation. So what are some of the things, just to make this slightly interactive, that are worthy of doing some client side validation here? Probably without too much effort, too. OK, so we can syntactically check the email address. We can be really anal and make sure that it only uses certain characters that are in the RFCs, as we hint at in the footnote in Project 2 spec. Maybe we can be a little looser and just make sure it's foo at bar dot something, or maybe foo at bar dot baz dot something, and not worry so much about special characters. But there's certainly an opportunity there, because that's sort of a syntactically interesting field. What else? It's matching the passwords, right? We can immediately tell the user, even though he or she can't see the passwords they've typed because the browser just shows bullets, JavaScript has access to the raw data, which makes sense because the browser has access to the raw data because it's actually going to get submitted. So we can at least check, does password 1 equal password 2? And if not, yell at the user. And finally, what else? Yeah. Just make sure all those fields are filled in, including the checkbox, perhaps. So how can we do this? Well, in form2.html, notice that I've gone ahead now and embedded a script tag in the head. So I know in advance that I want to do some sanity checks on this form, but not constantly. I don't want to be that sophisticated, right? I don't want to be checking at every character the user types. It suffices for me to wait until they click submit. And then at that point, if I detect before submitting the data one or more things is awry, I'm going to tell the user then and cancel their submission so that no data leaves the browser whatsoever. So to do this, I decided that, all right, well, really what I can do is just encapsulate all this functionality, these validity checks, in a function, and just make sure that function is called. So similar in spirit to our previous example where I wanted to call the equivalent of an initialization function on load, here I want to call a validate function on submit, on submission. So how do we set this up? Well, one, clearly I'm going to, in the top line here, going to be defining this function. But now let's ignore the code for a moment and fast forward to the XHTML. An astute observer will notice just one difference in this XHTML vis-a-vis form1.html. Yeah, so there are these attributes that can be attached to many different XHTML elements, namely form elements, that define event handlers. And there are certain events, we'll see a pretty exhaustive list in just a bit, one of which is onSubmit, which if applied to a form element means upon this form's being submitted by the user hitting enter, clicking outright a submit button, do the following JavaScript code. And so inside those quotation marks is the value of that onSubmit attribute at far right is literally a piece of JavaScript code. And whereas in yesteryear, you might have seen in a lot of examples JavaScript colon to make clear what's doing it, I've not seen a need in recent years for you to have to tell the browser outright to do that. So much more common is just to see the JavaScript code. But now notice, I'm not just calling the validate function. And this is a nuance to be aware of. I'm actually returning the value of the validate function. Because the way this particular event handler works is that if your handler, that is whatever code you execute in between the quotes, returns true, take a guess as to what the browser should then do. It should submit and let the data through. But if you return false, it should thwart the form submission and just no data should go anywhere. So the implication is that whatever I do in that validate function, it's got to return true if everything's OK and false if there's at least one error. And then the browser will take care of the rest. All right, so let's take a look up top. The validate function is doing the following. So that first line of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines of code, what's it doing? You can kind of infer it from the error message. Right? So if the email field's value is blank, well, that is, it equals quote unquote, you must provide an email address. All right, so let's test this out. This is form2.html. That's this one here. I'm going to go ahead and click submit. All right. So now I'm using, and this too is probably bad practice these days. No one really likes these pop-ups. For lecture, it's wonderfully easy to trigger an alert. Much more compelling, as we'll see in the Ajax lectures, would be to integrate maybe some red text or maybe like a little warning icon next to the field saying you need to fill this out. So there are different ways to do this. I went with the quick and dirty for tonight. Now let's see if I can circumvent this validity checker and then insert bogus data into the database. All right, submit. Now that went through OK. So this suggests that maybe a slightly more determined UI programmer might call the trim function that exists in JavaScript. So I can at least strip off some leading and trailing white space just to ward off corner cases like this. Maybe it's not really necessary. But the point is, though, that the if-else branch does seem to be taking effect here. And why did this thwart the form submission? Well, within that if statement, I not only alerted the user, but returned false, ultimately. All right, so what about the next one? The next one's doing the same check. If the password field is blank, go ahead and similarly admonish the user and return false. And this one, it's a little long, but I just kept it all in one long line. Else if, what's this one doing? Yeah, it's just comparing the values. I don't need to password 2 is null, because at this point in the branch, it suffices just to make sure that it's equal to password 1, which was already checked to be present. So this is just saying if password 1 and password 2 are not equal, then admonish the user and return false so that they can try again. And let me make clear, too, since even I make this mistake pretty often, even though the field is called email and the form in this context is called registration, and forms is the array of all forms, and document is the sort of Uber document that gives you access to all of this, it's not correct to say this. Because what email is at that point in the hierarchy is an object, an element in the DOM. And you don't care about the value of the object per se, rather. You don't care about comparing the object for equality with something. You care about comparing the value within this object for equality. So that is not correct. But the value of this field is what you want to get at. And we'll see the same for checkboxes. So I did the same for password 1, password 2. And what about this last one? Well, I'm not actually checking the value here. It turns out that checkboxes have an additional property, aptly named checked, which is a Boolean, which is true if that box is checked, if it's false otherwise. So I can check if it's not the case that the agreement checkbox is checked, also warn the user and return false. How would I do this? Well, we've not seen recently a checkbox. The syntax is pretty straightforward. But notice all I had to do was make sure I give it a name and then refer to it accordingly. All right, so let's try this. I'm going to fill in an email address, like malin@post.harvard.edu, password of pass, another password of pass. And now I'm not going to check the box just to see if it's working. OK, I must agree to the terms and conditions. Notice the form hasn't reset itself or anything annoying like that. Let's click this again. And now it goes through. And you see, in fact, what I submitted. But there's something slightly curious here, which is worth noting. What's the field that was submitted that's a little, well, there's a few fields that are curious as a result of our use of Google Analytics, which explains all those UTM fields. But why is agreement, quote unquote, on? I didn't type that in. Typically, yeah, if the box isn't checked, the variable often just doesn't get sent by the browser. So it's effectively not is set in PHP. But if it is set, it's not sent to 1 or true. It's sent typically by convention to, quote unquote, on. So you can pretty much check it for non-null. And if it's non-null, that means it was sent. Otherwise, it was not sent. That is, it was not checked on the server side. OK, so can we do better than this? Well, I'm already getting a little tired of copying and pasting this whole thing every time. There must be a neater way to do this. Well, there's at least one way. If we take a look at, and I'm not going to, let me roll back these changes. If we take a look at form3.html, the code's indented one more tab stop. But I've used a keyword that you've probably not seen in many languages, which is? with. So I introduced this, frankly, I'd never used it before this example, but in looking over Yahoo's libraries and a bunch of the online libraries that we wanted to recommend to the students in the course, a lot of them use it. So I figured we might as well at least show you how to tell you how to parse it. All it's saying is sort of setting a context. So resolve all subsequent variables against a base reference of document.forms.registration. So when I subsequently say email.value, that means append that to registration after putting a dot in there, just like we had in the previous example. So it's really just syntactic sugar. Doesn't allow you to do anything fundamentally more interesting, but it's perhaps not uncommon in some libraries out there. Yeah. Good question. Is there a way to print the document object in its entirety? Not typically, not, there's no equivalent of, say, print R that prints everything nicely. There is, we'll see, an inner HTML property, which allows you to dump an HTML representation of the whole page. But the way to get at the DOM itself and poke around would be with a client-side JavaScript debugger, at least one of which will point you in the direction of tonight. Yeah? Yes. And I don't think we have that one linked on the website, but I'll try to remember tonight to add that one as well. Yeah.
If you have multiple forms that you reference to for each, can you have multiple widths? Or do you just say document forms and then you name?
Multiple widths, did you say?
Multiple
widths. Oh, multiple widths. You can, I suspect. I don't know what happens if you nest them. I don't know if it's sort of, yeah, absolutely. You can have a separate context after this one with another with. Absolutely, sure. I'm just not sure what the behavior would be if you nested them. Yeah?
This is a silly question. So password 1.value is not equal to password 2.value. This is a pure text comparison with any security risk?
Is there any security risk? No. I mean, that the information the user has typed is in the computer's RAM, and it's in the browser's document model. To which JavaScript has access, there's no security risk in that unless you have, well, even that, let's see. There's no security risk if you trust all of the JavaScript that has been integrated into your website. If you are using, though, someone else's external library, you want to be sure that you actually trust that code. So for instance, Google Analytics is actually what's generating those weird HTTP variables that we're seeing going back and forth, the cookie values effectively. You want to be careful about who you give access to that kind of data. But even then, there are some security restrictions that we'll actually get into next week with Ajax that at least render that not really a concern if you do things properly. So let me leave it at that for now. Others? Okay. All right. Well, what else can we do here? Let's take one variant of this before we actually enhance the functionality. In Form 4, you'll see another approach to the same idea here. So notice that now validate isn't defined as taking no arguments, but it's being defined as taking one argument. And notice, incidentally, that I've not done any typing here. I'm not specifying the types of parameters. I'm not specifying the types of return values, much like PHP. You just don't need to. There's a lot of implicit casting. And in cases where you want to do explicit casts, JavaScript has the expressiveness for that. But for now, just note that this function is pretty much the same in terms of what it does. The only thing I've changed is its signature. Now, why was that? Well, a common approach so that I don't have to, for instance, start from the root of my DOM and go document.forms.formName.fieldName and so forth is to actually give the functions that care about manipulating this element in your document a hint as to which element you're talking about. So quite common would be to see something like this. And it's scrolling. Let me fix this to make it more clear. This is my form element in this example. And notice that I still have onSubmit, and I'm still returning, but I'm returning validate, the function of this. So this, much like in the world if you come from Java, is a pointer to the current object. The current object at this point in the story is the most recently opened element, which in this case is a form element. So the effect of this is to call, excuse me, the validate function with the equivalent of a reference to the current element. The implication being, I don't now have to dive in from the root of my document to go document dot forms dot so forth, because I've passed in this, which I'm aliasing as f, as my parameter here. So it suffices now to say that f dot email dot value is what I want. Because at this point in the story, f has been equated with document dot forms dot registration, because it was that form that was in context when I passed in this. And this is a very lightweight use of the this pointer, the this reference. We'll see much more compelling uses for it. But I again introduce this because you'll see this quite commonly in libraries and whatnot. Yeah? Good question. So there are other event handlers, and we'll see a list in a bit. You could put this handler on the button itself, and use the onClick handler, which frankly behaves as the name suggests. Upon being clicked, it will call the following JavaScript code. The catch with that is that forms typically can be submitted by hitting Enter. So you would be missing that case. So by calling the using the onSubmit handler, you handle both cases. But we'll see other uses for, we'll see use of onClick. Possibly tonight. All right, well, let's do now something. Now let's add some interesting piece of functionality. So all of these forms have pretty much behaved the same, even though the underlying code was a bit different. But now I want it to get a little fancy, right? I want to be more visually obvious that the user is not going to be allowed to submit this data unless they click that box. And so it's perhaps subtle on the screen, but what do I appear to have done here? So you can actually disable form fields in using JavaScript. And this is actually pretty common on a lot of sites that want to prevent. It's a little hackish, but to discourage duplicate submission of data. So for instance, some sites, perhaps when you click, I think even MySpace, just to come back to this, even though, again, I don't really use it, and you can look for my profile there. If you click login after providing your email address and password, the button's text changes to, I think, loading, dot, dot, dot. That's just a visual thing, maybe not all that compelling. But what some sites I've seen do, and I won't really challenge the utility of this for now, is when you click a button to, say, purchase something with your credit card, they'll actually then submit but still disable that button so that they can't click it again. It doesn't stop the user from hitting refresh or hitting F5 or going back and then forward, but it at least handles that one specific case where maybe they double-clicked because some, you know, maybe less savvy users are likely to double-click. And for a back-end database that's maybe not smart enough to catch duplicate submissions, maybe that's one way of just eliminating 99% of those errors, but maybe not all. I here just wanted to do it to prevent the user from even getting to the point of submission until they click that box. Now, you can argue maybe this isn't very clear, because I can imagine some users I've encountered over time where they'll be doing this ad nauseum and not realizing that this will appear. So maybe I should have added some descriptive text, but this is a class of programmers. Not going to worry so much about those details for now. But now, notice what just happened in the voiceover. If I only when I click this box does, and change focus, actually I should fix that. It's behaving a little differently in IE7. Only when I change the value of this and change focus is the button becoming enabled. If I uncheck this and then try to add additional data, it's going out of focus. And I think I'll tweak this so that it immediately does it on change and not when you change focus. All right, so how are we doing this? Well, this is form5.html. And notice that in the XHTML, I've only added one thing here to this input. Disabled equals disabled. OK, this is sort of a curiosity of XHTML. Whereas back in the day in HTML, for things like this, which have an atomic notion like checked or selected, you would just say disabled. Well, that's not well-formed XHTML. So the convention is actually to give that same attribute a value that is identical to its name. It's a sort of a remnant of yesteryear. But that's the way it's done. Notice that I've given this input a name this time, just called button. I've only got one. I don't really need to tease them apart beyond that. It's a submit button. And then the only other thing I've changed is this. I'm using now, OK, as promised, the onChange handler. So upon this field being changed, the agreement box, I want the toggle function to be invoked. So in fact, what might be better here, and we can try this in a second, is not on change, but maybe on click. We'll see if that works, at least in IE7. But let me scroll up now to this toggle function, because what this is saying is when the agreement checkbox is changed, invoke the toggle function. Well, what's that function going to do? Well, I still left the validate function in there for the whole submission. The toggle function is just doing this. If the document forms registration forms button disabled property is true, that is, this is equivalent to equals equals true, then go ahead and make it false. Else, if it's in fact false, go ahead and make it true. In other words, invert the Boolean value of that property called disabled. If it's false, make it true. If it's true, make it false. And the effect of that is that when the value of this checkbox changes from unchecked to on, the form field itself actually changes. The toggle function got invoked, and the disabled property was itself inverted. No, I set it to true here. Yep. I'm just.
Down below.
Oh, so this is just a distinction between how the XHTML does it and how it's modeled in memory in the DOM. So by saying disabled equals quote unquote disabled, you are declaring a little attribute node in the DOM whose Boolean value is either true or false based on the presence of that attribute value pair. So just an. Disabled equals true or false. So you can probably get away with that, frankly, in most browsers. But the correct XHTML way to do it is to give it a value that's identical to the name. I suspect the browsers are just being tolerant. Yeah.
So now, in this current example, this would be a form that would generally require JavaScript to be active on the browser, because since the default state in XHTML is for the submit button is disabled.
Yes.
So perhaps a way to sweeten that up would be to initially disable the submit button using some JavaScript.
Exactly.
With an onload for the body element.
Yep. Exactly. We could achieve the same effect by doing this. So to make clear Curtis's point, if JavaScript's enabled, but in XHTML I've disabled this field, the implication is that the user's never going to be able to re-enable this field. So maybe not a common case, but certainly one to consider. So if I get rid of that, but I still want to implement this notion of disablement by default, well, let me go ahead up here, define another function, say init. And then in here, I'll simply steal this line of code that ensures that that field is disabled. And now I just need to make sure that the init function is invoked. And maybe the most appropriate place to do that is in the onloading of the document. So call init there. And if I've made no syntactic errors and I reload this page, it is in fact still disabled, but not via XHTML, via JavaScript itself. So a good way of approaching that too. Yeah? Sure. So let me roll this back for a second. And what I'm going to do is change the on change, because it looks, I wrote this on IE6, which appears to behave slightly differently, which you will, if you don't already, come to appreciate the subtleties of. All right, so I've reloaded the page, hopefully effectively. Yep, much better. OK, so notice the distinction. Apparently, you learn these things by going or by Googling. In IE7, the onChange handler for a checkbox only gets triggered when you've not only changed the value aesthetically, but have given focus to another form element. So it's not an atomic operation, it seems. Whereas onClick literally captures just the individual clicking of that particular element. So a good thing to discover. And this is why, incidentally, you'll appreciate even more why we make this emphasis of getting your sites to work on at least two browsers, because you only, frankly, trip over these things by actually trying out sites on multiple browsers. And if nothing else, be thankful we're not expecting that you do it on, say, four browsers, because it very quickly becomes more of a headache and less of a fun programmatic experience. Yeah. When it's check the value. So simply for checkboxes, in the DOM, the way they're modeled is with this additional property that is actually just a Boolean value, so that you don't have to check the value, because that the idea of quote unquote on, I don't think is required. It's simply a convention. Whereas in the DOM model, you can now you can trust that that property will be a Boolean value, irrespective of what actually is the string value that's going to get submitted by the browser. So there is this slight gap between sometimes how it's modeled in memory and what's actually serialized over the wire.
Yeah. When
the way you coded your form, when you set it initially to disabled, you're also assuming that the initial state of the checkbox is unchecked. It's dependent on that checked attribute.
Yes, absolutely. It could be because it's going to toggle. Yes.
Correct, consistent with each other.
Yes, which is maybe not a safe assumption. Right. Oh, okay. So then that's a valid point. And it reminds me of when you have one of those universal remote controls in your house, and sometimes the TV's on, but the DVD's player's off, and you hit the all on button, and it. So yeah, same issue, but and definitely worth being more careful about, frankly, than I was here. Yeah, back here.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is. I think that's okay with transitional XHTML. No. I think that's okay, and if not, we'll actually see at the end of tonight another way of doing that by way of a function call to do it programmatically. So let me take the fifth on that because I'm not sure offhand.
Your code.
Okay.
Your code in function toggle. Seems awfully clunky to me. Wouldn't it be simpler just to say document blah 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 disabled equals not of itself?
Touche. In form6.html, what we have actually is not even a function, but just some inline JavaScript. Right? If I'm only going to do this in one place, ha, I win. So. So here, and arguably, it's a long line, but it's sort of write once, use once code. I don't really need to factor it out and add to the overhead of maintaining a function. Frankly, let's just do what you suggested, on change, which I'll now change to on click, simply invert the value. So document.forms.registration.button.disabled gets the opposite of its current value. And that has the effect of toggling it as well with much less code. And I'll go ahead now and change the on change to on click so that we handle this browser better. So a nice one-liner way of doing things too. Yeah?
If you changed all that document form registration button to just this .disabled, would it only act on that one input element?
If we actually did it to this, that actually might work. In fact, let's take a 5-minute break and I'll try that and we'll come back and begin with that question. All right, and now the grand finale. We haven't even touched the email field, which was the very first thing we picked on, and so I give you regular expressions in JavaScript, which are actually quite useful. Fortunately, the syntax is very similar to Perl and thus PHP and the preg replace and preg match functions, and there's actually at least two ways of doing this, the simpler one of which I'll show now, and I'll point you toward some alternative tutorials on the other one. I took a fairly simplistic approach. I just wanted to ensure that someone made a reasonable effort of typing a syntactically valid email address, something at something.edu, because I at least wanted to head off anyone without a .edu address. Again, you still have to validate server side, but if I do this, I'm making use of a JavaScript regular expression. And again, pardon the very long version. I went away from using with at this point. But if it's not the case that the registration forms, email fields, value matches the following regular expression, then go ahead and yell at the user and return false. So here too, do we see this instance of objects in memory having sometimes properties and sometimes methods associated with them. So even though JavaScript is loosely typed, there are some data types, which we'll actually come to in just a moment, types of objects. Namely, this email field is a DOM object. It's an, what was this? This was a form element, so it's an element in the page. The value, though, is probably of what data type? So it's a string. And so JavaScript has innately string objects, one of whose methods, a la Java, if you will, is a method called match. And match takes between forward slashes, not strings like PHP, but just forward slashes, a regular expression, the syntax for which is pretty much identical to what we've seen in PHP thus far. Match is defined to return true or false based on whether or not the pattern matches. JavaScript has some other functions like split. You can split something by some character like a comma or spaces into an array. You can do other tests as well, and you can use more powerful regular expressions such that use parentheses, for instance, to match substrings like you can do in PHP and Perl and the like, but I kept it simple for this one. So the only addition to this version is that I'm ensuring that someone's trying to register at least with a .edu mailing address. If I go over to this form 7 and just type in mailin@foo.com and then try to submit this thing, it's going to yell, provide a .edu address. All right, now I could get a little sloppy here and say, .edu. It's going to let me get away with that. So clearly not a full solution, but at least it's doing some sanity checks. And my goal was simply to demonstrate some basic regular expression matching. So for more on that specifically, only because we've seen it in another language, these would be three of the places to start. So there is a string object in JavaScript, the sort of canonical reference for which is at this Mozilla URL. There's a regex object as well, which is more powerful than the ones that come with the string functions, but it's a little more complicated to use. It's a little more efficient, at least if you're using regular expressions a lot, whereas the string class's use of regular expressions are compiled or interpreted at runtime, the moment you call the match function. For performance reasons, if you're doing a ridiculous number of string comparisons that maybe something like Gmail or Google Calendar that's just manipulating a lot of in-memory data might use, you can actually use the regex object because it has a compile function, which means you can compile the regular expression some internal representation. You don't have to care how it's done, but it can be compiled just once and then reused. So if you're actually benchmarking your site and doing something a whole lot, maybe Google Spreadsheets is an even better example of data that might be constantly being analyzed for some reason, you can get some performance gains by knowing about that. But a layman's introduction to these same libraries is not the official docs, but I would say our friends over at the W3 schools. Yeah. Yes, so this is all client-side. So older browsers that support older versions of JavaScript, or maybe even my phone for that matter, might not support some of these classes or these objects, in which case you would want to test for the version of JavaScript using any number of techniques, one of which is the simplistic one we said, by specifying the version number. Or you can simply test for the object's existence. And it typically suffices, and we'll probably see examples of this, if in your code you simply preface a block of code with if regex, that is, if that object type is defined in the document, then do this stuff. And you see, if you're familiar with some of yesteryear's JavaScript conventions, you'll often see something like this, if document.all, which was an object that only existed, I think, in IE or Netscape, one of the two. And if it didn't exist, it meant you had the other browser. So a lot of this hackery. But fortunately, a lot of this stuff is taken care of for, can be taken care of for you these days by libraries. Yeah?
When you say it's compiled once, that's once every time you load the page.
Yes, once every time you load the page, which means if you're doing.
It's only useful if you're doing a bunch of comparisons on that.
Right. On, say, hundreds of cells in a Google spreadsheet, for instance.
Well, almost the same question. By compiled, you mean?
Compiled, I mean compiled in whatever Mozilla and Microsoft have decided a regular expression would be when compiled in memory. And there may be some standard, but I've not dived into the details.
So it's converted into a more efficient form once.
Yes.
No,
it wouldn't be assembly, but it might be they're constructing some finite state automaton in memory and just keeping a pointer to that so it's not done every time. Yeah?
So is the match method an overloaded one? Just
take the Good question. I think it only exists within the string object. Well, so that's a bit of a white lie. Because of the object model that JavaScript uses, I don't know what the return value would be if you tried to apply it to some non-string object. It might just return null. Oh, can you pass in a double-quoted string? That's not the right way. I suspect many browsers might forgive that, but I'm not sure what the behavior would be. Don't adhere to the expected syntax. It's weird that you pass in a string between these things, but it's presumably has a history. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a good question. So what is the JavaScript nowadays was turned over to, I'm actually blanking on the entity, but it's ECSMA script formally, according to, maybe one of the TFs can quickly Google this and make me sound smart, some standards organization. And that wasn't always the case. I believe JavaScript originally came out of the Netscape group. And then over time was sort of usurped by Microsoft and extended in different ways. And then, frankly, I would refer you, wouldn't often do this, but Wikipedia probably has the perfect write-up on it. But for the most part these days, the browsers are pretty good at implementing what the world knows as JavaScript 1.5, but that's not necessarily the case. And so unfortunately, there's still a lot of hackery even now in 2008 in how you program cross-platform using some of these features. So there are standards. The question is to the extent to which the various browsers implement them and interpret them in the same way. Yeah?
European Computer Manufacturers Association.
European Computer Manufacturer Association. MA. OK, so it was close. Might have transposed two of the letters. OK. All right, so all these objects we've been talking about, there's relatively few. And I actually waved my hands at a couple that are related to errors and whatnot. If you really want to see, you can look at the Mozilla documentation, which I keep citing as sort of the canonical documentation, because I believe they are either involved with or originally wrote this particular specification. Here are pretty much the objects that are supported. And you don't have to type things by specifying what types of variables you're using. But when you are dealing with something that's an array, you have access to certain properties and or functions, like a length property, like in Java. When you have a Boolean, you can trust that it's going to come back true or false, because it will be the data type will be normalized to that if you explicitly cast something to a Boolean. Dates have certain methods associated with them, which is actually useful. So you can get back the hours component and the minutes component via standardized method calls. The math object has a lot of utility methods associated with it, like round and seal and floor, I believe, things like that. Object is more general, which we'll come back to tonight. We just took a look at these two, which is actually a good segue to what we even mean by JavaScript being object-oriented. So you will see, if you pull some off-the-shelf libraries, some pretty crazy syntax. And the reason for at least the following couple of slides is not so much that we dwell, at least in this class, which is ultimately meant to be application-oriented as opposed to a programming languages class, but to at least introduce some key syntactic features so that you can yourself, as a human, parse JavaScript that you might be reading of someone else's. But this isn't the sort of you could spend multiple weeks programming in an interesting way in JavaScript, and that's not the extent to which we're going to try to use it. We're using it more as a tool than as a beautiful language, so to speak. So the ways in which you can instantiate and manipulate objects are as follows in Java, in JavaScript. In JavaScript, an object is little more than a container that contains name value pairs. Those name value pairs can either be the name of a method and the implementation of that method, or it can be the name of a property and the value of that property. But at the end of the day, an object is just a container with name value pairs. How do you create an object? And those of you who are familiar with Java will recognize syntax like this. That first line there, var object, is declaring a variable in whatever scope I'm in, like the script between the script tag or inside of a function, of object, a variable called obj, and it's assigning it the return value of calling new on the object, the generic object constructor, although that's kind of a white lie. That is equivalent to the line right below it. So common syntax these days to create a new empty object is just to use two curly braces and not to bother with the overhead of writing new object, parenthesis, close parenthesis, semicolon. Just convenient. Yeah?
So how would distinguish on the second line between an integer string or an object?
You're not distinguishing. At this point in the story, we're just creating generic objects that are just empty containers. We have no values in them whatsoever. In fact, the idea is going to be to put in values that we want. So in fact, how do you go about storing something in an object? And actually, maybe to make this more real, an object in JavaScript is a hash table. You create an empty object, you can now start putting key value pairs, name value pairs, anything you want, and the browser figures out how to get that data when you request that field. So suppose I want to store some value. Maybe it's a number, maybe it's a quote unquote string. I've just genericized it here by saying value, but you can put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, where value is on this slide. I'm going to store in the object called obj at the location, I'm going to define a key called key and associate it with the following value. That is equivalent functionally to this. So just as objects can be thought of as containers for name value pairs, just as they can be thought of as pretty simple hash tables, they can also be thought of as associative arrays. And just because folks sometimes like to think in this way, and because it helps avoid some syntactic gotchas, this line is equivalent to that line. And this second line is maybe most familiar now that you've been playing with PHP for several weeks. So this is equivalent. So if you were to define an associative array in PHP to add key value pairs in JavaScript, you would use create an empty object, and now you could start defining key value pairs in that way. Both are, at the end of the day, equivalent, except for some obscure corner cases. This last one is actually an approach you'll see in libraries a lot. Folks, code written by folks who like to create the appearance that they're very sophisticated when it comes to writing JavaScript, sometimes at the expense of readability, frankly. All this is saying is the same thing as those other lines. I'm declaring a variable called obj. I'm, with these curly braces, instantiating an empty object. But then simultaneously, am I defining a key in there with this value? So just to make this more concrete, rather than calling this key, if this object was meant to represent a student, I might say something like ID, and the student's ID is 12345678 9. And that'd be equivalent to writing this, and that'd similarly be equivalent to writing this, and 12345678 9. Okay, if I'm not doing ID though, but maybe the student's name, then you would use quotes and say something like this. So many different ways to implement exactly the same thing in memory.
Mm-hmm. You need to do the new object as opposed to the last line?
You do not. So the only time you need to call new is when you're explicitly invoking the function. And the reason for that is that, so JavaScript is a classless, object-oriented language. So there are these built-in object types, but you don't go defining a student class and a person class. And you can do inheritance, but you don't do it as explicitly as you do in, say, C++ or Java. So the subtlety of what's happening, and I think on the course's website under resources, I link to an OOP-related tutorial for JavaScript for the curious. It's by no means requisite. The new keyword, actually, you don't really need it here because the effect for many cases is the same. The only difference is when you put the new keyword in front of object, which is actually just a function, is that you're setting within that function's call, you're defining the this reference so that it exists, so that if I go implement this function, I'm going to lose 99% of folks here, I think, if I keep going late. Let me come back to this with a different example that I think I prefabbed.
Mm-hmm. Do you need to say either of the first two lines?
Do you say it one more time?
Could I just say object.key value?
No, in that case you would probably get an error unless the browser is being very forgiving.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yes, so one of the first two lines is necessary. Okay. Yeah. Yep, just comma delimited. And in fact, if we really want to get crazy, and I'm trying to avoid getting crazy here, what you're really seeing here is if I bring up a template here. So if I'm doing var object gets, let me write it like this. So if I have an ID, I can set it by default. Let me come back to my prefabbed example just to see where we're going with this. But again, this is meant to be more of the syntactic introduction than this is how you're about to start programming. Yeah?
So if you say var object equal 5, would that have a key value?
If I said what?
Var object equal 5, let's say 5.
OK.
Would that object have a key and value?
No. So if you just said var object equals 5, semicolon, the number, you would actually be getting effectively an object of type number that you. I mean, you could actually add things to it, but then you'd be moving away from some of the built-in functionality. It gets a little weird. Like, you get the upside of JavaScript being fairly loose when it's prototype-based, object-oriented programming, where you don't define explicit classes, is it gives you a lot of flexibility because you don't have to worry about the overhead. You don't need to do all the stuff, the overhead of packages and class names and inheritance hierarchies, all that specification you need to do in Java, say, to keep things very neat and orderly, which actually has some compelling upsides. But at a price of a lot more forethought, a lot more planning, a lot more design, and that's JavaScript is meant to be more lightweight, and so that's why you see this relaxation for the most part.
So, is there any difference between Java objects, JavaScript objects, and arrays?
Not really. Syntactically, and actually, let me move to this, and then we'll backpedal if need be. So, an array is just another type of object, but that has some predefined methods and/or properties associated with it. The most obvious one of which is dot length. So, if you want to declare an array in JavaScript, what you can do is either of the two lines above. So, you can either explicitly say new array parenthesis semicolon or just square brackets. And now you can start adding data to that in this fashion. So in this case, I'm storing at location 0 in this array foo, and at the next bar, and at the next baz. That, however, is actually equivalent to doing something like this. The nice thing about JavaScript arrays is that they're dynamic. So dynamic in the sense that they're like vectors more than they are arrays proper. So they will grow to fit the data that you want to put in them. So these three lines here are actually functionally equivalent to these three lines. Because the first time I execute this line at the beginning of the story, a.length is initialized presumably to 0. So I'm storing at location 0 foo. But the moment I do the assignment operator, this array is really a vector that's just increased in size and memory by 1. So now a.length is 1. I do it again with bar, that grows length by 1. So at this point, I'm now saying a bracket 2. So this is useful so that you don't have to know a priori what the size of an array is if you want to start adding elements to it or some similar tricks when we get to, again, the Ajax stuff. Yeah?
So in
yes, you can have key value pairs of different types. And in fact, one of the examples we'll see in a moment is actually going to assign a function as one of the values as opposed to using a raw value. I mean, at the end of the day, these things are almost, you wouldn't do it. So let me say no, to keep it simple. So no, you would use slightly different syntax, if nothing else. But at the end of the day, they're pretty much all objects. Okay. Yeah?
Basically, it's a hash map,
right? Yep, hash map, hash table, all these things. Associative array, sure. OK, so let me pull up this example. So, and again, this is meant to empower folks to be able to read various libraries and APIs that are out there more than it is, here's how you're about to go program stuff. All the stuff that's expected, for instance, of Project 2 for validity checking was the stuff we began with, right? All that quick and dirty, a couple lines of code, and you're done. This is just meant to ensure that you have means of reading and possibly writing more, say, advanced JavaScript code. So if I wanted to mimic the idea of class-oriented programming, and I wanted to create a class called foo. Well, the way in which I would do this in JavaScript is to define a function called foo, but that is defined, for instance, to initialize, like a constructor often is, some fields within to contain some value. But I don't have to pre-declare them. I can just say this.counter equals 0. If I now want to append a method to this, I can do this in a number of ways, but maybe what you see very commonly done is the use of this special keyword. So the takeaway of this slide is just exposure to this keyword. This.prototype is essentially saying add a key called add to the prototype of this. Is this out of context? Let me use the real source code example in our OOP directory, which you do have a printout of tonight. OK, let me start with this one instead. So here is a bunch of code inside of a web page, because I wanted to be able to execute it, but I didn't actually bother making a real web page. I'm just going to use the alert function so that I can see what's inside of some variables that I'm creating. So this is a script in the head of my page. I now am defining what I'm calling a constructor, but is really just a function. All right, so it's really just a difference of semantics here. But I'm writing it as though it's a constructor. So capital F-O-O is the name of a function. But I could have called it anything, and it doesn't have to be capital, because it's not actually a class. It's just like a class, for those of you with an OOP a background. I'm defining a property called counter, because I needed some kind of contrived example here. And I wanted to have a function, a method associated with this foo class, and that method is quite simply meant to be an add function that takes one parameter and increments, when passed a value, the counter by that value. And this is why I said earlier that just as keys' values can be 1, 2, 3, or quote unquote David, so can they be the equivalent of a pointer to a function. Because a function is actually just an object in JavaScript. And if this is kind of going like this, that's OK. It's just meant to expose right now. So at the end of this curly brace here, I effectively have what a Java programmer would think of as a class called foo and in a constructor that initializes a counter field called 0 and defines an add method that just takes one parameter and adds. All right, so now let me use this thing. So now I'm going to instantiate an object. But really, I'm just calling a function called foo. But because I'm prefixing it with new, it creates a new chunk of memory that I can access by way of the this keyword. And now I just want to print out the counter. So if you've kind of been following along at this point in the story, when I reach this line, what should be printed? Yeah, 0. At this point, I'm calling f.add, which is really just a property of f. But because functions can be properties, and because the convention is to put arguments after functions in parentheses, I'm calling effectively the method called add that's associated with this object, which is defined to take in an input and increment the value of counter by it. So at this point in the story, alert says 1. OK, and so we introduce this now because we'll see an instance of it in just a moment in the UE library. The most interesting piece of syntax to take away from this is this fact that I'm defining a function on the fly. Those of you who've had taken a class in Lisp or Scheme have talked about functional programming or lambda functions, lambda calculus, this idea. I effectively defined a nameless function here. PHP has this same idea with a function called create function. You can create functions. Cool. OK, I'm the only one who's apparently done this. This is creating a function, and it's just retaining a pointer to it, effectively. So what's the takeaway here, really? Well, if we go back to this example and execute it, just to confirm, in our oop directory, oop1.html, the first value is 0. The second value is 1. Now let's actually see why some of this syntax is useful. So in the case of our website, we have the following code. Let me check one thing. We have the following code. So inside of at the top of every page on the course's website, we actually have a line that's including a file called course.js. And that is sort of the JavaScript that I wanted to be common for the site. OK, for various reasons, some stubbornness, some because it's a little bit illustrative, I wanted to reinvent the blink wheel. Right? I was really upset when Microsoft and Netscape and the like took that away from me a long time ago. And I'd really like to be able to put open tag blink, put some text that I want to flash, and close tag blink. Specifically, if you noticed it, there is text that blinks on occasion on the course's website. Right, when office hours are in progress, or virtual office hours. And actually, for that sort of minor use, I think it's compelling. But you can disagree if you'd like. But I needed to re-implement this idea. Right? And I won't claim credit for this idea on my own, because I didn't even know you could do this early on when I first implemented this idea for a different class's website. But all I've done is this. Here's this file called course.js. I just wanted to factor the code out of the website. But I could have pasted this between script tags in every page. I'm defining a function called blinker. And I'm calling first this line. So take a guess as to what this line of code does that I've highlighted. Yeah, so remember that document object. And I said there are some built-in methods associated with it. Well, one was called getElementById. There's another one called getElementByName, which literally grabs all of the elements that are named something specific. So in this case, this means that if I've got a web page that looks something like this, hello, what that's going to do, and maybe I've got some other text on my page for whatever reason that says goodbye, what those lines of JavaScript are going to do for me are return an array of elements, storing them in a variable called blinks. because that's what the getElementsByName function does. It returns an array. And I know that from having looked in the manual. So what do I next want to do? Well, one of the neat things you can do with JavaScript that's now sort of pushing us beyond mere validation of data and silly little focusing on form fields is that you can actually affect the aesthetics of the page too. You can change the CSS aspects of the page. You can give a different class to an element, a class in the CSS sense. You can change the style attribute's value. So if you've ever had some inline CSS with style equals quote unquote, you can change that on the fly. Now this is actually useful even in the context of like client-side validation, because if you wanted to, for instance, highlight a field in red if the user doesn't type it in, well, the easiest way to do that is to probably slap a new stylization on it, or maybe just associate a new class name with it that you've defined in an external CSS file. Well, how do you do this? Well, most elements in a JavaScript, in a web page have a style property associated with them in this thing we keep calling a DOM. That is, one of the properties inherent to any of these nodes in the tree is called dot style. And you can affect, for instance, the style of the page just by changing its value. So notice what I'm doing here, and it's pretty simple code. I'm using a JavaScript for loop, the syntax for which is almost identical to PHP or other languages, but you don't use dollar signs in this language for variables. I'm saying blinks bracket I. So just to be clear, what is that giving me? The very first blink element in the page. Then I'm saying dot style, so that means take that element, literally the thing between the open tag and then the close tag, and grab its style property, which maybe is initialized to nothing, because in my blink tag I didn't have blink space style equals quote unquote, but this time I do want to add something, and specifically I'm going to access the CSS property called visibility. And if you've never seen this, CSS allows you to control the visibility of an element by either displaying it or not displaying it. And that's really all blink is. I want to turn it on, turn it off, turn it on, turn it off. Visibility on, off. So really, I just want to toggle that field. And let me actually switch to the slide where I rewrote this code a little more simply as this. If the visibility of this current blink element is quote unquote visible, which is what CSS defines the possible value to be, then make it hidden. Else, if it's actually hidden, make it visible. So this function effectively toggles the visibility of every blink element in the document. But there's one catch. This is going to execute this loop once for each of the elements, but have we finished implementing blink? No, all we've done is taken all the text on the page, like hello and goodbye, or the office hours, and turn them off. Right now we have to have someone turning them back on, and then someone turning them back off. How are we going to do this? Yeah, so JavaScript provides you with the ability to set timers or timeouts so that you can invoke some piece of code again and again. And the code with which we're doing that is this. You can do this in different ways. But we, for the courses website, and we'll preach this in this course, have gotten into the habit of using a library, namely Yahoo's, to provide us with a standardized way of setting triggers for the page, defining event handlers. So this line looks a bit cryptic because it's doing a bunch of different things at once. But we've included, in addition to those UE CSS libraries, we've also included some UE JavaScript libraries, one of which defines the equivalent of a class called event. And just by reading the documentation on Yahoo's website, I realized that this class has a function or method called addListener. You pass it first a reference to what it is you want to be listening, what you want the library to be listening to. And just like document sort of refers to the whole document, window also refers specifically to the browser window, kind of more in an aesthetic sense, if you will. But we'll tease those apart a little better over time. So I'm saying listen to anything that goes on inside the browser window, but for specifically for the following event. What event am I clearly listening for? The load event, just by putting it in quote unquotes. And I took that from a list of possible events that I could define handlers for. And now here's the use of function. Because my goal is to have the Yahoo library invoke a function anytime the page is loaded, which frankly is just once, so I could have done this in a slightly easier way, I need to define that function. And because I myself am never going to call this function, but only Yahoo is going to call this function, I don't need to give it a name like foo or init, because I'm never going to call it again. Let me just give it no name, which I can do just by calling that keyword function, open parenthesis, close parenthesis, a lambda function, if you will. And then between curly braces, notice that this is a one-line function. This function, which is nameless, is supposed to do what when invoked? Yeah, it fires blinker every 500 milliseconds. Or more specifically, the moment the page loads, this nameless function is invoked. And this nameless function's one line of code calls the setInterval method on the window object and says every 500 milliseconds, invoke what's between the quotes, namely the blinker function. Now, setInterval is not setTimeout, which is another function, another method that JavaScript offers, which just gets called once. It's like setting a timer, an alarm clock, wake up. SetInterval, as the name suggests, says do this again and again and again ad infinitum, whatever is inside of quotes. So the effect is that my blinker function is henceforth going to be called every 500 milliseconds the moment the page loads. So why did I take this approach? Well, this will become more compelling as the examples get larger. But I could have actually just put that line of code, window.setInterval, blinker, comma, 500, and so forth. I actually probably could have gotten away with putting that as Peggy was hinting at earlier with the onload handler between that. The catch is that the more sophisticated your sites get, and the more Ajax-y, I dare say, they get, the more code you might want to have being loaded at startup. And very quickly will that onload attributes line of code just get ridiculously long. Better would be to factor that out. But also, if you start integrating other people's libraries into your code, you can't just sort of selfishly define the onload handler if some of those libraries need it too. And so what UI provides by way of this add listener function is an abstraction whereby I'm adding a listener in the sense that I'm appending it to whatever chain of onload handlers has already been defined elsewhere. So I myself don't have to worry about appending myself to a list of event handlers. Rather, it does all that for me. And even though on first glance tonight this might be crazy complicated or even still a little confusing, at the end of the day, it actually makes your life easier because you don't have to worry about the low-level details of how it is you chain multiple onload event handlers in much larger pages. So we've gotten into the habit, even in the course's website, of doing this, just because then we don't have to think about it. Yeah?
To implement all of this, you have to add elements to your HTML.
Mm-hmm.
Whose element tag name is blink.
Yes.
Is there some way to do this without making it invalid HTML?
Excellent. So I did that just to demonstrate that we could resurrect the blink tag. Rather than use get elements by name, what I could have done is actually could have done this in a couple of ways. Could we have done that? We could definitely do ID, but you don't want to have multiple ones in the document. And I have to check if we use get elements by name, if I just do name equals quote unquote, if that would grab the elements too. If names, in other words, if you use it as an attribute as opposed to the raw name, the tag name. So let me check on that. So,
name equals blink.
Sorry? Yes. Yeah, exactly. Or you could do it with the CSS class. If I just say I define a class called blink, I could actually get back all of the elements that are in this specific class and do it that way as well. So I just did it this way just for nostalgia's sake. But yeah, there are multiple ways to do it. And just a takeaway, what I put on this page here, on this slide here, this is a link to a big HTML table that some guy was nice enough to put together. You will recall that, first, just as elements in DOM have a style property with which you can change the CSS style, they also have a class name property, which allows you to change the class. So rather than inline CSS, you can just respecify a class that's in your CSS file. The problem is, and I'll just pull up this URL to make it clear. And that's not a typo. I think he just couldn't get the domain with an E. So you might recall in CSS, if you've gotten pretty savvy with this stuff, properties like border color, border left, and all these kinds of things hyphenated. Well, unfortunately, the right hand wasn't talking to the left hand when these languages were invented. So JavaScript defines all of those same properties using camel case. So not the hyphens, but you alternate between lowercase and uppercase letters. It's stupid. You can guess what all of the mappings are, but I just gave you this URL to make clear what's going on. This is CSS. If you want to express the same in JavaScript, you do this. It's a nuisance, but such is our world. All right, so Sorry? Yep.
Mm-hmm. So that can exist on top of my own
function. That's what you meant? No, so UE, my use of the event class, so to speak, in the UE library obviates my use of the onload handler explicitly. Like, I don't use in the course's website onload equals quote unquote. And to do so would probably, UE's smart enough to actually figure that out. It would detect that you're using it and then add to that list. But it's sort of, it should be an either or. If you're going to have multiple onload handlers, use a library like this, or you're going to have to reinvent the wheel with which they're doing it. And frankly, the UE library is open source. So if you're curious as to what I even mean by how do you add multiple onload handlers back to back, just look at the source code for this method in their own downloadable JS files. But let me forge ahead just with some mentions of exactly where UE fits into what's out there. So today was really meant to be about some of the syntactic details to give you a sense of the features of JavaScript and, again, to lay the foundation for the dynamic part of the continued dynamism of the course with our Ajax discussions. However, what's increasingly compelling about JavaScript, too, frankly, is just how much freely available code there is out there and some really good, dedicated people who have just tried to take the headaches out of a lot of the stupid cross-browser issues so that you don't have to worry about them when just trying to get real work done. I personally am a fan of UE because they have so much code available. It's well maintained, updates come out frequently, they have good support for it. However, there's some even sexier ones out there, like Scriptaculous is quite popular, Dojo and Prototype. I would say anecdotally, I've had better success with this one just being more robust and better tested, but that could just be my own personal experience. So if you're looking for some fancy effects, for instance, in JavaScript, I don't imagine you would want to recreate most of these things yourself, just given how much time has clearly gone into them. But Scriptaculous provides you with, for instance, that ability. That was not Flash. So that was all CSS and JavaScript, DHTML more generally going on. And that's just the half of it. Let me actually go to drag and drop, which I think we'll have some examples of. I actually always find their site a little confusing. Let's see, demos, which is ironic for a UI site. Let's see, autocomplete, and let's see, drag and drop Ajax shopping cart. OK, so it looks like this is my shopping cart down here. And I'm guessing I can click this thing, which is just an image, drop and let go. And now apparently a mug's in my cart. Not sure this is a compelling UI, but it suggests that you're trying to do this and doing the redrawing and detecting the onMouseOver event handler and the onMouseMove event handler. There's a lot of work going on underneath the hood to get that to work, not only in IE, but also in Firefox, Safari, and other browsers. And these libraries, you're certainly encouraged to use them for the courses project and the final project, but just know that they do take a lot of the headaches out of some of this cross-browser stuff, specifically UI features. And incidentally, for that semi-exhaustive list of event handlers, the ones that you can typically just write in your XHTML to define handlers for are these, which frankly are pretty self-explanatory. We already saw, for instance, onClick and on change. If you ever wondered, especially years ago, how people could allow you to hover over an icon and it would change what it is, maybe it changes color or whatnot, it's typically done by the onMouseOut and the onMouseOver event handlers. You can detect clicks, you can detect key downs and the key coming up, like Gmail does for its keyboard shortcuts. You can detect whether a field has been blurred, that is, the user moved away or they focused on that field. You can detect resizing of the window and so forth. Just FYI, if you define event handlers for these same events using UE, you omit the word on from the front of them when you pass in quote unquote load, for instance, to the add listener method, if you recall from this example a moment ago. Yeah? Ah, good question. How do you make the page Yahoo aware? So the way to do it would be to actually just check their documentation. Oh, Yahoo's great because of the standardization of their pages and their profuse examples. They have these little boxes that tell you to paste the following line of code into the top of your file, which is pretty much what we did for the course's website. Though for performance, we actually downloaded the freely available library and just put it on our own server. Yes, so if you're going to use the library, and you'll see profuse usage examples on their site, but you would do something like yahoo.util.event.addListener, which is sort of a hackish but only way of defining the notion of a package in JavaScript. You're really just defining an object hierarchy. But let's actually take a quick look here. So I mentioned these various toolkits. So I pulled up Scriptaculous quickly. Let me actually go back to UI, which we've thus far pretty much just used for CSS. But just notice how many little tools they allow you to put into your toolkit here. I actually gave us a list. Let me turn to this real fast, since their names rather explain what they do. So in Yahoo's library utilities, you have the ability to animate things like make progress bars grow and shrink, that kind of stuff. A drag and drop utility, similar in spirit to what we saw at Scriptaculous. Image loader for sites that are very image heavy, maybe like a Flickr-like site, maybe a Google Maps-like site where you want to preload a lot of images. That's an annoying wheel to reinvent if you want to just load a bunch of images in the background. Their library makes that a little easier to do. Controls and widgets, an autocomplete widget. So when you start typing in a text field a la Facebook and it tells you who your friends are automatically, same idea there. A calendar, if you just want to have a prefabbed calendar that just lets you choose dates, they have one of those. Choose colors. Menus, like hierarchical menus, if you want to implement that, sort of similar like a file menu or an edit menu, and a whole bunch of other stuff. Let me ask you, let's demo at least one of these. Which one do you want to see in action from? It's some kind of license that is very flexible and that you're allowed to use it in even commercial websites, so long as you maintain attribution.
TreeView.
TreeView. All right, so let's go back to the UI page here. Scroll down, TreeView. Okay, so what this is going to do, I'm just going to click, I'm blindly going to go to their examples page. I'm going to blindly go to their folder style TreeView design, because that sounds interesting. And now it looks like, thanks to their JavaScript library, I'm presumably able to define these various labels in the hierarchy, and I myself don't have to worry about any of the aesthetics here to create this hierarchy. So you get these just black boxes that you can plug in your data and let them worry about some of the functionality. How about the animation is actually a little neat. Let's pick up one of those. And what's nice, incidentally, is there's a lot of libraries that you might encounter via Google that do some pretty sexy things, but they work just on Safari, or they just work on Firefox. It's not all that useful when you're trying to make a real website, frankly. How about animating animating colors? Not seen this one before. Click Run. OK, so things like this. Questionable value, perhaps. But basic animation, how about this? All right, that's kind of cool. So things like this, where a lot of sites, frankly, turn to Flash for these sorts of things, which for some reasons, accessibility, portability, you might not want to resort to. You can recreate a lot of that, as I think our friends at Google have been demonstrating to the world. So what about all of the quirks and the gotchas you encounter? So a really wonderful guy who I think has a book out there, which this website is really meant to drive you toward, has this site called Quirks Mode, which frankly, if you're ever looking to debug some weird corner case or trying to figure out what properties does this browser support versus this browser, honestly, Google the queries you're interested in and then append Quirks Mode to the string, because he's tended to discuss all of the nitty-gritty details. This is sort of like the last place to turn to for some esoteric information with respect to JavaScript and some CSS details. So I thought I'd at least make that pitch there. Static code analysis. So this is not in your printouts because I thought of it too late. But JSLint, which is meant to be a JavaScript version of the popular C utility from yesteryear, is a syntax checker and a little bit more. It's a web page that you can go to. And if you copy onto your clipboard some JavaScript code you've written and you want to check it for validity, syntactical correctness, you can paste it in there. And not only will it find obvious errors, like you're missing a semicolon probably here, things like that, it will also point out maybe some syntactic choices you made that might not be universally very well supported. So it's a nice place to just, you know, do a sanity check on your code. Think of this similar in spirit to the W3C's validator. So, but it's a different idea since this is obviously a more complicated language than HTML. How do you debug this stuff? There are at least two that I've used. I'll post a link to the DOM plugin for Firefox as well. Firefox, frankly, tends to be a great browser for at least developing and testing code in. I personally use this one a lot. JavaScript Debugger, it sort of says what it is. You install it into Firefox. You go then to like the Tools menu and choose JavaScript Debugger. Then you visit a page that has some JavaScript. And the most useful thing, the thing it's most useful for, is actually giving useful error messages. So probably everyone in this room has either created or visited a website where there's some JavaScript error, and the extent to which Microsoft went to give us debugging information is that stupid yellow icon in the bottom, and then an error message that's object doesn't exist, where, and when, and like it's completely useless, and Firefox isn't much better. This thing will tell you line numbers, and will give you a quick link to the actual source code that was downloaded. You can set breakpoints, and you can step through the code. It is a godsend when it comes to JavaScript development. Maybe there are others out there, but I'm a huge fan of the latter, freely available. And now compressors. So it's sort of apt that we began this discussion with an emphasis on JavaScript being client-side. The gotcha there is if you're worried about intellectual property and putting code out there that you put a lot of sweat into, anybody can take it. Because if it's client-side, it means the client's executing it, which means you have to send it down the pipes and give free rein to whoever's executing it. So you can't encrypt JavaScript. You can't compile it and then send it down to the browser. A smart person will, even with these tools, be able to reverse engineer your JavaScript. However, there are at least two motivations for using what might be called compressors more generally. One, just save space. JavaScript, like a lot of languages, have a lot of white space. The code probably doesn't change all that often. You might as well at least strip out the white space. You, a human, might like really long variable names and descriptive function names. Browser doesn't care. Why not replace all the functions with names like A, B, C, D and save some characters, honestly? So this kind of idea is implemented by various tools. These are perhaps some of the most popular ones. Some of them make an attempt to sort of obfuscate or encrypt the code, which is not really an accurate description, just to make it harder for folks to figure out what the code is doing. But if you look at any popular website these days, they do it both for compression reasons and also a bit of IP protection, right? It's one thing if a really determined adversary could reverse engineer your code, but if all I see is a huge string of characters with no white space, no useful function names, and really lots of it, it's probably easier for me to just go figure out how you implemented your code and write it from scratch than steal your code. So just realize these tools exist, but realize that, you know, if you're, say, working for someone who says, make sure no one can steal our code, that at least you know what the implications are for trying to implement that idea. So in theory, it should make it a little faster. But if we're only talking 1 kilobyte, 2 kilobyte files, it's probably immaterial. And you want to beware some of the obfuscators out there that actually encrypt the code by effectively sending down the wire a key, encrypting the JavaScript with that key, but also sending down the wire the decrypt function, which uses that key. So you're going through all these hoops to sort of protect your code, but really from only someone who doesn't really know much about programming. So it's all about just raising the bar when it comes to obfuscation. You can't keep people out of it. So with that said, good luck on projects too, and we'll see you next week.